The next test or application of the oscilloscope is in effect a continuance of the look at ignition. I've chosen the continuance because there's quite a loading. There's about 16 amps or so of loading on this component, the inductor, the primary side of the ignition coil. And it's a good opportunity to look at power on ground. Now there's a nice little triangle here. Current, power, ground. Current can be measured anywhere in the circuit on the power supply or the ground reference. Therefore, current to me is the first choice. Always, if a component uses current, whether it be a pump for motion, or a current for heating, or a current for inductance, as in our case, measure current first, because current proves the other two. I want to reverse that process and explain the relationship between current, voltage drop, and ground reference. So that's why we've done this as a continuance. To understand the electrical load is proportional to work done. In other words, if you increase workload, for example, I use a fuel pump as an example. The amount of current absorbed by the pump should be predictable. So if you say creating, should we say, 5-6 bar of pressure, and you expect to see between 4 and 6 amps of current, and you increase that pressure by a factor of 2, then your current will rise proportional to the increase in work rate. That's how we can establish if the consumer is working too hard. So in that case, we'd use pressure gauges as well as a scope. That's an example of what I'm trying to get at. So to understand the electrical load is proportional to work done, the skill sets to establish a relationship between power and ground whilst looking at a consumer whilst it's under load. In other words, it's actually performing its normal duties in a normal environment. Once again, go back to the fuel pump. It is no good running the pump on the bench when there's no fluid in it. You're wasting your time. It's got to be in its real environment. So, we've set up, picking up off the number 3 coil again. I've left current measurement in. I've removed some of the other probes we had before because I want to look at trigger, the power supply, the ground reference, and the current. Probes. It's worth talking about probes because the business end of the scope are these little chaps. And we make our own. No surprises there. We buy them in kit form. We use sewing machine needles, which are graded by size, including the nice fine ones for silk and some very coarse ones for denim and leather. So we buy our own needles and we produce our probes. We also use surgical hypodermic needles, which come in all lengths and sizes. Yes, they're hollow, they do not break. And they have a very nice little feature on the end that prevents them from shorting out against each other. So why do we go to all this trouble? Well, you know what? When you work in a very, very confined area, you need this kind of accuracy with probes. So we use anything from paper clips, not so much these days, but paper clips to needles, whatever it takes to get into the circuit. And we actually have some probes that are that long, that can reach very deep into a component if we have to. So we use what we have to. So I want to run the car to explain the setup whilst it's running, but let me perhaps talk about scaling and voltage and time base. I've retained the same time frame before, which was 1 millisecond per division, because we still want to use the triggering event. Channel A is the focal point of ignition, because we're looking at voltage drop and ground reference, which is all to do with primary. So we're looking at the triggering event. We're still looking at current ramping in red, as we did before. Green is now the power line, the power supply, and red is ground, and black is current. Black is current as it was before, red is now your ground reference. So that's the setup. Let's run the car and look at the relationship between all of these events. The trigger remains unchanged from before. Power on, 5 volt, trigger from the ECU. Whilst the trigger event is taking place, current is allowed to run through the circuit. Now, current proves power on ground. Let's assume current wasn't correct. So, trigger, output, power, ground, current. Let's assume current wasn't correct, which it is. We need to look at the power supply on load when the event is occurring. Now, depending on the load, remember that voltage drop proportional to load, the load of this ignition is around 16 amps. I would not expect more than about 1 volt drop on load, peak voltage drop, in that supply circuit measured at the component. Now we can see that if we zoom into this, you can actually see there is a voltage drop whilst it's on load. We need to establish what that voltage drop is. You can see there is a ground reference on load, and if we follow across and scale it, 0.4, it's about 0.3 of a volt, 300 millivolts on load. Now, if you attempted to measure this with a multimeter, you're not going to get any usable values at all. It will average the events out and give you an RMS value anyway. So we need to concentrate on absolute references. If that ground reference were poor, current will diminish, the energy created in the coil will reduce. All is bad news. That is a good reference. Now you notice there's quite a lot of noise in that reference. Once again, you lose a very low voltage setting. We've got 1 volt range from there to there. You introduce noise. Do I need to filter it? No, I'm fairly happy. There's a lot of noise there, but I'm happy with it. I do want to establish what the voltage drop on power is. Now there's two ways of doing that. An obvious one is draw a nice little box around it and just use a pair of cursors. Pull one down there, that's offload. Pull a second one down, on load. Measure the differential, 329 millivolts. Yep, 0.3 of a volt. That means an excellent voltage drop. It's actually a touch more than that, but very good voltage supply. So the circuit carrying the voltage to the component is good. The ground reference is good. Therefore, we can consume the correct amount of current during the event. Another way we can look at that is to change from a DC setting to AC. At the moment, the green channel has a DC coupling. If I change that to AC, that gets rid of ground. We can now change the scaling to a very low reading, 1 volt, and now measure differential as an AC value. Should give us the same numbers we had before, but let's have a look. So we start with offload there, and we measure peak on load here, 384 millivolts, pretty much the same as what we had before. You pay your money, you take your choice, whether you go an AC coupling or use the zoom and measure it with cursors. So let's just remove those changes, go back to 20 volts, and go back to a DC coupling, and then we have voltage drop on load, trigger, ground reference, current. They are the four critical factors when looking at an inductor under load. So when measuring a device that uses energy for inductance or movement or heat, it is very important to have, and in our case it's a triggered event, which is four fingers, so it's trigger, output, power, ground, current. Then we need all of this to establish correct functionality. As I have always said, that the energy, the consumption of current in the circuit should be purely from the device, the consumer only, and none of it represented by the actual circuitry itself.